let us peep into that next problem. The next problem had one S above that, right? I am going to solve only a piece of this, not the full thing where the process is going to be same. Now, there is a S term S in the numerator. The transfer function, that it will not be there. So, is some term with some gain, maybe you continue with 6, it does not matter. So, there are two ways again of doing it. The first way is very simple, again do by T of S is A S plus 2 S has disappeared. No. Koi shak? Anybody has any doubt? If the order of the denominator is more than the order of the numerator, there is nothing in the numerator. A, B, C, D, etc. Koi shak? Like these military people keep asking. Koi shak nahi, it is correct. So, this is easy. So, method 2 does not actually depend on whether there is a S in the numerator or denominator. I get my standard for my circuit looks identical. Then it goes here and goes here. Absolutely not worried whether there was a S in the numerator or not. My method is all uniform. So, what is the uniform advantage? I only know this, how to do it, that is all. I do not know any other form. What are the other forms? Other forms are required if I have to do this in random. So, I go to method 1, what I have to do, I can be smart and put this here, does not matter. So, koi jyada choice nahi hai, ek S upar aana hi padega. One of them has to have S. So, now I have to design two different types of circuits and put them in random. So, now I have to have a circuit which gives me this. So, the solution is very easy. I have a circuit going like that. Of course, do not take my word for it. I am going to design. So, this is my Z in. So, this we call it R1 C1 and this simply RF. So, what is the Z of this Z in? R plus 1 over SC1. So, in my output, the transfer function is minus ZF by ZIN. So, minus ZF is a simple resistor RF, and now I got this. You want me to write, I will write it, but SC1 R1 plus 1 upon SC1. So, it goes up minus RF C1 S upon SC1 R1 plus 1. I got that. So, this is what I get. So, this is the second circuit I have to remember. So, once I get this second circuit, I am happy. So, if I know both circuits, I can always do this. I can always, and then I am not limited by any number of terms. I have lots of varieties. If you give me S plus 1 and S square, I am still okay. Now I can have one of them as S upon S plus 1 into s upon s plus 2 into 6 upon s plus 3. But you give me a polynomial s square plus s and all that, I should be happy doing it by partial fractions. Partial fractions is a magic. As if it is magic, it will remove. Partial fraction does not care. So, partial fraction does not care. So, what is the vote today? What is the vote? Partial fractions, if you do well, you are the happiest person, because then you have to remember only one type of circuit. One type of circuit is this. Then, as a routine policy, choose this arbitrarily and then you get the other two. So, ekdam mug up karke udhar chale jaane. But now we have to mug up the method. So, now we have to understand why method 1 and 2 are different. And which one is easy for you? It depends. If you can know both the circuits, you can tackle s upon s plus 1, that is also easy. That is another circuit. But I personally feel that knowing one type of circuit and one procedure is much better. So, I think today's tutorial, therefore, and we have lots of question answer time, that a tutorial session when I take it, I spend first half an hour in giving the background. Do not assume that they have understood in the class. Repeat it. Repeat it. Like I have not gone into the details of it, but I repeated it. Then take the simplest form. The problem is difficult. Take one simplest form and do that. Then show that this simplest form can go some distance. Then show an anomaly or some satellite problem where that cannot be used. Then you have to do that also, and then finally evaluate which method. Of course, we should know all methods. As a student, I can ask them to do this by only using tandem circuit. You know, I can give an examination where I do not give a choice. Solve this by using 3 op amps in tandem, or I can ask them to do it by partial fraction followed by a summing circuit. But as a student, I should know both the methods. So, this is the breakup that you have to give. Now is the question, which I will take a few questions now. Is this called design or is this called analysis? This is called design because I am finding all values of components. If I do not give this at all and draw a circuit, let me draw it more carefully so that it looks decent. V 1 of t 10 kilo ohm, 100 kilo ohm, 10 microfarad, I remember that, so I put it. Then I put another one, kilo ohm, 1 microfarad and 10 kilo ohm does not make sense, 100 kilo ohm. Then I find the function V of t if V 1 of t is a step function or V 1 of t is sinusoidal. This is called the analysis problem. I have given all values, then you have to determine what is at the end of it. The other one, I have given only the formulae or the transfer function, and I have asked you to derive. No reference was given for anything, you have to find all values of components. But as I told you, since only two conditions are given in, after all, what is what was it realizing? Say some 6 upon s plus 2, let us say. That means when s was very small, it was 3, and the product of this was equivalent to 0.5 s plus 1, that means the product of the resistor and capacitor was 0.5. That means only 2 conditions are there, but I have got 3 values to be determined. So, I begin with 1 arbitrary. So, very clearly you have to write what is that arbitrary value, and then everything becomes a design. So, if you similarly make an amplifier with gain of 10 and there are 6 components in that amplifier, there will be 5 arbitrary values of components, and that is why in the laboratory that amplifier does not work. Because you give only one specification and there are 5 values of components, so it should not be like that. You have to say that this is the 12 volt supply, quiescent point should be right in the middle, you should specify. Quiescent point should be at 6 volt and the current should be exactly 5 milliampere. So, 2 conditions you have to mention for quiescent point, and then you have to say the gain should be so much, that is the third condition. The third one you have to say the total power in that amplifier should be so much. Fourth condition. That means you have to bring down the unknown values to 1, and only one unknown can be taken as arbitrary. Because you just say make an amplifier of gain 10, then everybody will do anything, and there is nothing left in that. But good practice actually believes that quiescent point should be in the middle, etcetera, etcetera. But to a student, we cannot hope, because he cannot do this. He cannot find 5 arbitrary values for one specification. Even I find it difficult to you know imagine some 5 values which are arbitrary, and then so I have to have a process. So madam has to give me a sheet after this class we will meet, give me a analysis procedure and the instruction for full design, you said, no? The instruction for full design therefore is at the most only one arbitrary parameter. One arbitrary parameter is okay, but even here I can remove that arbitrariness by saying that the range of resistors cannot be less than 1 kilo ohm here. I can put some condition that you know, do not use any resistor 1 ohm, 10 ohm like that. So, the resistor here cannot be less than 1 kilo ohm, resistor anywhere cannot be more than 1 mega ohm like that, I can put condition. So, even that arbitrariness becomes within limits. And therefore, I think we now know if this appears easy to you, it is not necessarily easy for students. For the student, design is equally difficult compared to this. This also is difficult. From this, he will be spending all the time in getting this y of f, then inverting it, and after that, he will be converting it to polar coordinates, Cartesian coordinates, and it will drive him crazy. The students are very fond of getting into a corner where they do not know what to do. So, I keep telling as a thumb rule to all students, in multiplication and division only, I need polar coordinates, that is magnitude and angle, and addition, subtractions, algebraic, I need Cartesian coordinates. So, this is like a plus j b, but I know they can get totally confused. So, this problem many a student will not able to find that final function, though it is very easy, but they will be able to do the design, because the design is very easy. Because from this value to find this value is easier, but to go on actually doing it as if from fundamentals, then it becomes tough. So, somewhere you have to be more familiar with one type of circuit. So, if I am familiar how to design this circuit, I am comfortable with partial fractions. So partial fractions have solved my problem forever. Any filter with this kind of characteristics, I have solved that problem, because I get only one type of circuit every time. So I think I stop this tutorial right here. If I just show you that second problem of the tutorial, because I had asked students also to do it, we will just think over it. So what do you say? So now I am of course for partial fraction, but if you do not want to do it by partial fraction, what are the choices? You can do 8 of s and all this plus 16 upon all this and split it, but it goes a very wide distance away. So in this case, I cannot even advise that you know do it in any other way, simply partial fraction, because s plus 2 is the problem, because that plus 2 has come. So in partial fraction, there will be none of these. So a upon s plus 1, a upon s plus 3, a upon, I mean b upon s plus 3, c upon s plus 5. So that is why I left it to students to partly confuse them, because for the problem 1, I have given 2 methods. Problem 2, I have expect them to try both methods, and they should go crazy with the second method, because there is a problem there, s plus 2. So let us have a little discussion, if you are not too tired, little discussion on what is that connection you have to make between theory and reality, which is called laboratory. So my suggestion is now this way. Suppose there are 9 laboratories to be done in the next big course, right? How many days? 10 days, 10 afternoons, maybe 9 of those afternoons are laboratories. Maybe 2 simple laboratory problems, so maximum of 18, I do not know what is the final number on that, but otherwise even if you take 9 lab problems, none of them should read as what it reads today, in my opinion. It should not read common emitter amplifier. It should not read like that. It should say audio amplifier. Speaker resistance is 32 ohm and the power is 220 milliwatt. At least I have to create a few more specifications, and of course audio amplifier immediately implies up to 16 kilohertz cut off. I want it between 100 hertz to 16 kilohertz. So please, you try to understand, I have to create as many specifications which are relevant to operational this audio amplifier, not for confusing the student, for making him zoom onto the reality, because he has an amplifier, this circuit. So this is my speaker, so I show it like R load. And I have got this RC, RE, CE, and I have either this kind of biasing, and then I have got this capacitively coupled here, and I have got a source here. Then I can say audio amplifier, this is a microphone. Microphone has got total range of 100 millivolt of signal, and its internal impedance is 150 kilo ohm. So why am I creating so many details? Because our student has to find this, 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 this and this, assuming that the beta does not play any role, beta should not play any role. See, in any amplifier, beta should not play any role, as long as beta is more than 150. It should not have anything to do with it. I am just saying, any microphone will have a very large resistance. If it is a capacitive type, piezoelectric type thing, its resistance is very high, but signal is very high. If you have got a magnetic coil type, then signals will be in microvolt and the resistance will be small. I have just specified one. So it sets a tune as to what this resistances will be. the 220 milliwatt sets a tone, what should be the current flowing through this? We anyway know that this is the frequency range, so probably this will be known from that, this will be known from that, etcetera. So this decides the lower frequency, right? It has to pass 100 hertz at least, and this has to give me some gain at 16 kilohertz or more, depends. So what I am saying is not that I am trying to make that problem complicated, actually I am giving a proper hint for him to have 5 unknowns, right? He has got 5 unknowns, I must give 5 conditions. So I feel that we should create that many conditions, at the most one arbitrary thing. One arbitrary thing will get you there. So what it means is when the maximum signal is here, I must get 220 milliwatt. That is what it means. This is the maximum signal. So gain is not even specified. Otherwise, if you do not give this value, you say the gain should be so much. So give me any other laboratory session that you did, I want to word it with some solid specification from reality. Say multivibrator you will be doing using op amps tomorrow, right? So suppose you want to make this multivibrator for making a digital clock. Digital clock. So after some frequency I create, so this is my original clock, and after some 2 raised to n division, I should get 1 second, right? Then I must use a divide by 60. 1 minute, and I use another divide by 60 to get 1 hour, then I use divide by 24 to get 1 day, etc. So we are not making a multivibrator just like that, I am making to this specification, that is the criticality. In the process the student will also know. What is all this? He is not going to make all this, but he has a specification to do that. So that means this 2 raised to n will decide what frequency he will choose, 4096 hertz. So any frequency near about multiples of this he will choose, otherwise the poor fellow will make a 1 hertz oscillator and it will not work properly. So you can now specify that he has to make it either 4 so called rough number 4 k hertz, the other one could be 32 k hertz nearby, the exact number is some nearest 2 raised to p, because crystals are now available with that kind of frequency 32 k hertz, some 32 some other 3 digits, so that now we can have this division to bring exactly equal to 1. So let him make that oscillator and get that frequency very close to 4096, that is his objective. Instead of putting any resistor or any capacitor and getting any frequency, you should not even tell him that he should make this frequency, you tell him that this is the job, I need a vibrator at the beginning of it. So like this, please invent a word statement which is connecting it to reality and provide him with enough information about his design so that he can design it, and all the other design parameters will be corresponding to your op amp. The op amp, you say that the resistor cannot be less than 1 kilo ohm nor it can be more than 1 mega ohm, and secondly the capacitors will also have to be not going too much away, you say the range of capacitor should be 0.01 microfarad to 10 microfarad, I do not know, 1 microfarad, to give me a range. And let him choose a frequency which is in multiples of this, either higher or lower. So I think it gives him a little challenge, he thinks that he has made something, the original experiment remains the same, but there is a focus and a purpose. Mention any other experiment, what you did first day, lighting LEDs, clamper and clipper. Any applications we know? Yeah, but any real application? No, that is a function. You are describing a function. Where is it required? Which real application can be used? I know. Possibly, I don't know about that. Anybody else? Any real application? No, you want to use a clipper here? No. This. Yes, it is. No. These applications are finished. I am just talking about this third experiment that we had like that, right? Or you had another one like clipping 5 volt, 5 volt, both sides. Is there a real application? We are making the circuit is okay. Is there a real application? There is a real application. If you have got a board in which lots of ICs are there, right at the beginning, so there is a board, power supply and all that, right? This is the power VCC or VDD and minus VEE. They should be actually having a clipper or clamper attached to it, which has this characteristics of, suppose we want to limit it to 5.5, no, at 6 volt. So when it is 5 volt or plus minus, it won't do anything. But you cannot by mistake apply 110 volts or by mistake apply 12 volts, it will clip it. So clipper and all this is okay, wave shaping I also understand. The wave shaping is not clipping and clamping, but wave shaping is creating a thing like this or creating a strobe like monostable. Monostable should be used for creating a strobe like this. At the falling edge, I create a strobe. So, a monostable use for creating a strobe of a given width. So, when you give a monostable project, you must say that these strobes are used for activating sequential circuits. And we cannot just depend on a differentiator which gives a very narrow thing and all that. I must give a 100 nanosecond wide strobe. A nice square pulse of 100 nanosecond, while this could be 1 millisecond. So, when it goes down, I must create a strobe here. So, when that switch for counting people going in the lift and coming out and all that, it cannot depend only on the thing which is going down. At that point, it should create a strobe, which the next circuit will not miss. So, the strobes of some very small amounts are very good as an example for monostable experiment. So, a monostable multivibrator experiment should have a preface like this, that this is going to be used for strobing and operating a toggle flip flop. So, this should go to a toggle flip flop, and students have to demonstrate that after such a strobe is created and given to a toggle flip flop, it flips. So, such exercise has to be given, which is a little beyond that, making a monostable. Otherwise, the people will make a monostable of any arbitrary value. Multivibrator, I already told you that you should mention that it is likely to be used in a wall clock. So, they have to appropriately make it worthy of 2 raised to n, and the nearest sample frequency is 4096. So, they can take it long, a bigger one or a smaller one. A monostable, we can give that. The pulse shaping circuit, the transient, for example, if there is an experiment on DC transient, so you have a pulse going like that, and I want a transient to either do it like this, quickly go and saturate, or do it like that. That means it is not even saturating before that, and then it falls down like that. So, we say that I need a curve which has a small time constant both wires going up and coming down, then you should give a variation that this should be 1/10 of the pulse width, because in real practice it should never go anywhere near it, otherwise you end up in getting almost a triangular wave. And the next exercise can be that this should be of one different value and this is of different value, so this slope can be different. So this time constant is different and that time constant is different, because this is called wave shaping. So we have this need for a pulse is coming and I have to find out whether this particular pulse, a real pulse will be somewhat like that. In a real application the pulse is like that. So now I have to find what is the width at half power or half value. So now you say given a pulse like this, which is a distorted version of this, so rise time is different, fall time is different, and you have drawn a very generic pulse, ask the student to make something to find the width at this point. So he should study the pulse shaping circuit in this way. So he has to create this pulse by this time constant tau 1 and tau 1. So this is tau 1 and that is tau 2. So it should begin like that. For example, all these astronomy people make this experiment about neutron, measuring neutron shower and all that, and they get pulses like this. So from these pulses you have to really, you will get an idea what is this width of pulse, and this is typically in nanoseconds. So you have to say that these are very, very short pulses, and of course nanosecond if you make, then student cannot do it. You should say it is a small 100 nanosecond width pulse. So they have to find this width. So in a sense you are asking them to create a similar pulse. So that is the connection, like that you invent, and I think every center should have freedom to invent that part of the story. We will also try, if you keep, if as and when we prepare such a list, we will also try to, for example, the audio amplifier I already created full. The filter of op amp I already created a full story, right. We are now defining my filter and I am now designing according to that. So similarly we should create a connection to reality for each of those experiments, and then becomes very easy for student to determine all parameters, otherwise there is so much flexibility that he would not be able to determine anything at all.
Practical should be on that only. What I personally feel.
Here we were not teaching anything. The lectures were just sample in the real one. Correct, correct.
In the real workshop.
Yes, yes. So if the practicals are 9 × 2 = 18, that means there should be 18 lectures also.
Yes,
right. That is what I understand. But I think the practical should be less than the lectures, because you cannot just grasp everything in one lecture. A 1.5 hour lecture, you cannot conduct a 1.5 hour practical, it is impossible. So I think 18 lectures and 9 practicals is more like it. And in the practical you should have those satellite problems like I do. So when I give you a particular thing, you say okay, determine what you can do to move the frequency this way, that way, etc. So I agree with him perfectly. Two lectures of 1.5 hour each should lead to a reasonably good practical. The only thing is I am requesting organizers, I will also be party to that, to furnish a real connection or connection with reality. Not only the connection, it also makes specifications for that practical, so that arbitrariness of that practical goes away. So how do you reduce the arbitrariness normally? By making ready made kits. See, what is the college doing by ready made kits? It is removing arbitrariness, otherwise student would not be able to do anything. That is the reason why we are doing ready made kits, is not it? Because we have no arbitrary design possible, with students they will not be able to do it. So we only say, oh, ready, either input laga, either output measure karo. So instead of that, now there are professors who are going to attend next time, we must specify as many parameters as possible, so that the arbitrariness goes, and then we do not have a ready made kit, I mean ready soldered circuit for it, we have to make a circuit. So, I perfectly agree, madam, please note, suggestion came and I agree with it, that if there are 2 1.5 hour lectures, only one practical should be aimed with that, and that practical should have a few variations connecting it to some reality, so that the students are able to make connection with it. Not 18 practicals, you have got 9 slots, right, 9 afternoon, even if you have 3 hours, you make enough variation in that practical to make it worthy, because we found 1.5 hours, we cannot actually do so many things. Yeah.
Thank you very much.